me. So I'm going to have start off with just a little bit of introduction about myself and the company that I created, the Heller Fundraising Group. And we're going to use the slides as a focal point. There's a lot of information on them. You're going to get them, as Natalie said, after the webinar, so you can go back and look. So really just, you know, relax and try to absorb as much of the information as you can. So I'm going to have to get my technology working. So here we go. First, a few things about the Heller Fundraising Group. If you take a moment and just read our mission so you have a sense of what we're up to. Then this is a smattering of our clients, both past and present, give you a sense of the types of organizations that we've worked with. We are located in New York City, although we have clients really spread throughout the country and sometimes overseas, but a lot of these are New York City based. This is our team, combining both our staff and our consulting partners. We have a handful of other consulting partners that are not here, and actually a brand new team member who just joined us last week, who's not yet on here, and who's on the Zoom today listening in. These folks are located both in New York City and throughout the East Coast, in fact. Just to really drive home what we do, it's really five areas. Feasibility and planning studies that lead up to capital campaigns for nonprofits that are usually above and beyond regular programs. And then we help development offices with the ramp up if they need to raise more money than they're currently raising, or figure out how to introduce more staff or focus their staff in the right areas. And then we help nonprofits build major gift programs. And just like today, we do training and coaching in all of these areas. So let's start, you know, this is about raising major gifts in three easy steps. So the first thing we wanna do before I do the big reveal on those three easy steps, which I think you're gonna love, let's talk a little bit about what major gifts are and set the table with a few other things. So my definition for today are these four things. We're talking primarily of significant gifts from individual donors, the dollar amount of what you would define as a major gift for your organization is gonna vary on the organization. I usually challenge any organization, no matter how small, to set the bottom rung for their major gifts at $5,000 from an individual donor. And then there's this rule that many of you have probably heard, some 20% of your donors are gonna give you 80% of your money. And so that means your major gifts are really a very important part of your donor ecosystem. And getting major gifts can happen either with or without a capital campaign. We do a lot of work on capital campaigns. I'm not going to dwell on the dynamics of them today because that's a whole nother conversation. But if there are questions about campaigns, you can feel free to ask. And this slide, I'd really like you to take a moment and let this sink in. This slide is really important because major gift fundraising happens at its best when you're doing what we like to call transformational fundraising, transformational relationship building. And it's very different than what is often referred to as transactional fundraising. So take a moment and look at these two different columns here. Oops. All right, so with that information in your heads, I'd like to do a couple quick polls so we can get a sense of who is on this call. Zoom. So would you please type into the chat, or Natalie, is it the chat or the Q&A you want them to type into?
The chat, please. Okay. Let's keep the Q&A for where you submit your questions.
Okay, so please type the number 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5 into the chat. And Natalie's gonna report back on what we have. See, the number's going up, so thank you for listening. You know you're not yet asleep. All right, do we have one or two more?
So far we have nobody from the board of directors, but other than that, it's pretty spaced out among executive director, development director, and other development staff.
Okay, super. Thank you for letting us know. And we have one other fun poll just to get a sense of your background. So have you ever met with a potential donor face-to-face and asked for a major gift? Please type in either just yes or no. All right, what do we got, Natalie?
We have only 2 yeses, the rest are noes.
Okay, so we get those 2 yes folks to lead the rest of this webinar. All right, thank you everybody. That gives me a really good sense of things. I see a couple other people responded. Are there any other yeses?
Nope, all noes.
Okay, super. Not at all a problem. And I hope this is going to provide all of you some really great information. So, one or two other things before we get into these 3 steps. Over the last couple of years, it's become really obvious to me that those organizations that have done well during the pandemic and are going to do well in the future are those that wake up in the morning and believe 100%, even more than 100%, that what they are doing for their communities is vital and it's really, really important for the future of their communities. And when I say the nonprofits that have done well, I don't just mean in terms of fundraising, but I mean in terms of providing whatever it is your mission is to provide, whether it's a social service or musical theater, whatever it is, you have to really believe that this work you're doing is vital really for the future of humanity in your little part of the world. And if you get that into your bones, then the fundraising is gonna be, it's gonna be palpable. People are gonna be excited by what's happening in your organization. So I promised you 3 easy steps. I'm gonna deliver. Let's start by just going over what are these steps? Because what I find is that the reason that we decided to break it down like this and it being the major gift process is that people need strategies and structures in order to do this hard work and to do it well. And with these structures, you're going to be able to think about the whole thing a lot more clearly. And I actually want to just take a step back for a moment and ask Kelly Mahoney, who's on my team and who's here with me today, is going to post in the chat a link, I'm doing this now so I don't forget, to our website where you can download some free tools that'll further help you with this process. And some of them are some of the materials that the spreadsheets that we look at today together. So if you'd like to grab those, Kelly will put that in the chat and you can do that during the webinar. I'll try to remember one more time. So getting back to the 3 steps, let's just dive right in. So the first step is to get organized. Before you do something hard, if you want to do it well, you need to be organized. The second step is once you're organized, you need to schedule your meetings. And these days, a meeting is not always in person. A meeting can be on Zoom, it could be a phone call. There's a variety of ways you can have a meeting. And then step three is you meet and ask for the gift. And this is a process that goes on and on. So you're going to repeat this. You're not going to be one and done on getting organized. You're going to get organized again and again. You're going to continually schedule meetings, and you're going to continually meet and ask for the gift. The interesting thing to me about these steps is that they require sort of a different thought process and a different sort of structure for each step, right? When you're getting organized to do something hard, it's very different than if you're talking to somebody about your nonprofit. So you have to kind of put yourself in different shoes in each part of this part of the process. And what we're going to do basically for the rest of our hour together, and we'll see, hopefully we'll finish up a little bit early, have plenty of time for questions and comments. What we're going to do is we're going to look at each of these steps. And quite frankly, there's a lot of information inside each one of these steps. This is what we, as a consulting company, we spend a lot of time with our client nonprofit organizations working on the details of each. So this is really a high level picture with some important spreadsheets and details, because I just want you to understand the process when you've left here, and then just don't be afraid, just start practicing it. Start getting organized, scheduling your meetings and meeting and asking for gifts. You'll always have the chance to improve more and more. Okay, so, and this slide is simply there, power and understanding. It's there because if you're able to really grok this process through what I'm gonna talk to you about over the next half hour, you know, that's the first step in taking action. You're like, okay, now I have a three-step process to do this either better than I was doing, for the few of you who have already been asking for gifts, and hopefully there'll be some value for you, or to just get started on a process I wasn't really quite sure how to get started on. So let's go. Getting organized. I'm going to go through a number of things that I believe are important for getting organized, and one at a time. And with some of them, I'm going to show you some organizational tools. So the first thing is, if you're going to go and email or call people to try to get a meeting with them, you have to know who that list of people is. And you have to have that somewhere that's easily accessible. So the first thing we want you to do is to create a list of your potential donors. You want to focus on gifts that will make a difference and set the bar. Like I said a few minutes ago, when a nonprofit is just starting out on this activity, we advise them to have a brainstorming session among just a, you know, not like 10 people or 20 people, but maybe three to five people. Maybe an executive director or a board chair, and if you have a development person. And get out a Google sheet or some other way to track things and have a conversation either in person or on Zoom or whatever works for you, and just start brainstorming. Okay, who can we put on this list that if they wanted to, we don't know if they're going to, but if they wanted to, we're pretty sure that they could write us a check for $5,000 or more. Let's just put all those names on this list. And what you want to do is you want to make sure you don't edit yourself. Just throw the names down. It doesn't mean that if somebody's name goes there, you're ever going to contact them. They might come off the list for some reason. But just start by putting all those names there and see what you come up with. And I'm going to show you now a tool for a few minutes that we use. If you download the free tools that Kelly put in the chat. Yeah, this is one of the tools. It's called our top prospect report. And I'm, the little green arrows at the bottom, I'm going to show you a few different slides with this report. They're what we're going to talk about at the moment. So right now, you want to put the first name and last name of the person in this report. So you get your group together and start brainstorming, you know, so-and-so and so-and-so. Just put their names down. No editing. The next thing is when you're putting their name down, it's a great idea to, to remember, make a note about their connection. They, you know, here are some examples. They're a friend of so-and-so, they're a donor, it's a foundation contact. It's okay if, like, if you have to, you can put foundation people on there. I'm more interested in individuals, but I'm not gonna stop you from putting foundations. Okay, once you've done that, I like to have people put a target ask. It doesn't mean it's what you're necessarily gonna ask the person for once you get going. But somebody who is the owner of the biggest business in your town and you know has given a lot of money to the local library or the local whatever, you can put a different number down than somebody who is a neighbor who, you know, drives a nice car and you think might have money. So you wanna start, this is not the end of figuring out how much they might give or how much you're gonna ask them for, but it's just the beginnings of a sorting process. You wanna do that. So if you get, let's just say for argument's sake, you get 25 to 50 names, you can then look at them. Maybe you wanna sort them by the ones that you think could give the most, and you're gonna start with those people. You then, like if there are some other notes or comments, just, you know, scribble down a few things. Don't make this your database. Like you don't need to put their email address, their entire donor history, et cetera. This is just a prospecting, getting organized tool. So if you have another note or so, you can put it there. And then the most important columns in this thing are these two, the next step date and the next step. And I saved them for last, there's a reason. Once you've got them and you've sorted this and you're a little bit further along in the process, you're ready to actually reach out to people. You wanna start sorting these by a date of activity. If you have, again, let's say you've come up with 50 people. I don't care how large your organization is, you're not gonna reach out to 50 people in a single month, especially when you're just starting up. You wanna reach out to a smaller number. Maybe, I don't know what it is for you, maybe it's 10 people. So you wanna titrate the number of people each month by the number of people you can reach out to. I'm gonna show you a tool for doing that in a little bit. But so if it's 10 per month, and you're starting, let's say you're starting in February, you're gonna put a date in February with 10, and then you're gonna put a date in March with the next 10, et cetera. And the next step, which is the middle thing there, is the thing you're gonna do by that date. For a lot of people, it might be send an email asking for a conversation. Other people, you may have to reach out to, maybe you have to talk to a board member about this person before you reach out to them. So it may be, talk to so-and-so about this person. You have to make clear what your next step is so you can begin to move forward when you're all organized. So the next step in getting organized is developing a gift table for an annual or a bigger campaign goal. And Natalie, I've actually been talking for a while, so I'm just gonna pause and see if anybody has any questions about that.
We do not so far, but just a reminder, you can stick your questions in the Q&A section whenever you think of them.
Thanks, so I'm gonna go on. So once you have that, you wanna develop a gift table so you can structure your asking. And here, I'm gonna show you a few slides with a sample gift table. And again, if you download those free tools, there's a spreadsheet with a gift table where columns are dynamic. So if you want to change the dollar amount, it'll adjust the other columns. Almost every goal we divide into three levels. Leadership gifts, which are the highest, major gifts, which are a little bit lower, and community level gifts, which there are usually the most of, but are the lowest level of giving. All three categories are vitally important, but if you look at the numbers for a minute, in this particular example, 50% of this goal, $250,000, is projected to come from the leadership gift level, which is only 8 gifts. So you really need to focus on these gifts for this goal. And you know, your situation may be different. This is just an example. The target number of gifts, obviously, let's look at the very top line. Gift of $50,000, 2 of those equals $100,000 in that second from column, second from the right. We generally suggest that you have 3 times that number of prospects to be able to secure that gift. Okay, so 2 times 3 is 6, 6 times 3 is 18, et cetera. See, the same thing is true at the major gift level and at the community gift level, because the gifts are smaller, we generally say 2 times the number. Some people actually think it's actually more than 3 times for the community level. I'm not going to argue that point. You just put in a metric there and it works for us. So you'll see, if you look at the total line for this particular goal, you would need 150 prospects at these various levels to get $500,000. So right away, as part of your organizing, you need to look at your database and say, well, how many donors do we have? Do we have at least 150, if not maybe several thousand? And within those, can we identify 150 who we think would make gifts at these various levels? It's a great organizing tool. And then I already pretty much went over this, but these all equal, you know, the last two columns, the numbers there equal $500,000. And then those are the summary by level. So another thing you need to do in getting organized is determine who is going to cultivate and solicit the donors. It's not everybody in the organization, and sometimes it's just one person, but you have to be clear who's going to do the job. Otherwise, the job's not going to get done. Often it's a combination of a development director or a development associate and the executive director. Sometimes there's a board member in there. I strongly advise against anointing your whole board to do this all at once. It's just gonna be a chaotic situation. Then you wanna be able to calculate how many meetings those people who are going to be doing this work can do every month, because, and I'm gonna show you that in a second, but you just think for a second, if we go back, here, if you need 150 gifts to raise $500,000, and let's just say for argument's sake, that's your annual goal. How many meetings can you have a month to get that goal raised? So here's a little table we put together also in those free tools. And I see there's a question. So after I go through this, I'll stop for the question. This table helps you figure out your metrics towards monthly meetings and how that adds up potentially towards an annual goal. So let's just look, there's a lot of things on this table, but just let's look where the arrow is. You see that year 2, the energetic level, that's just what we're calling it, means that a nonprofit is able to figure out how to have 8 meetings with potential individual donors every month. And that may be 2 people doing that work, or 3 people, or 1 person. In my experience, if you can have 8 meetings a month, you can raise a lot of money. 8 meetings a month is 96 meetings a year, 8 times 12. We're going to assume, for a variety of reasons, that in half of those meetings, you can ask for a gift. And then just to be super conservative, we're going to assume only half of those people are going to say yes to your gift right then. And because now the numbers all the way in the right That's going to really depend on how much you're asking for. But let's say you have identified people who can give at least $10,000, some maybe a little bit more, some a little bit less. In this organization, it's a bit more than that. But if it's $10,000, you could raise $240,000 from this metric in a year. Of course, if there's a couple people in there who are going to write you a $100,000 check, that's going to blow that out of the water. Nice when it happens. Sometimes it does happen. So the last piece of getting organized, and then we're going to move on to step number two. The last piece of getting organized is to determine your story. And the Heller Fundraising Group is really, really committed to helping nonprofits figure out what that story is. And we do webinars based on, you know, partially based on the whole case exposition. So for now, what I'm going to say is that story needs to be a powerful and, in fact, irrefutable message about how your organization is making your community stronger now and in the future. It's not about your organization being stronger. It's not about your donors. It's about making your community stronger. And Natalie, before I go on to step two, just want to pause and see if there's a question or two.
Yes, Joe is asking, will it insult a donor if you ask them for too much?
Oh, Joe, I love that question. Thank you. So I think you'll see when we get to the meeting part, I give a few tips for how to structure the meeting. And in fact, those of you who might want to email me, you're going to get my email address when Natalie sends out the slides. And Kelly, if you also want to put my email address in the chat, we put together another handout that has some hints for meetings, including things to say. So anybody who wants that is welcome to it. If you email me, I'll send it to you. But Joe, to answer your question, generally, it does not insult somebody if you ask for too much. And we usually advise that you ask for too much rather than too little, with the caveat that anything you ask your donors, just like anything you ask anybody for, I'm sure I'm dealing with a group of polite, conscientious, caring people. You want to be nice on how you ask it. And we usually advise that you couch your request in sometimes conditional language. You know, you could say something like, while I don't know the details of your financial situation, I'm wondering if you might consider a gift of X. So we find that that sort of thing helps if they're like, oh my God, that's so much, you know, it helps buffer that. Natalie, anything else before we move on?
Nope, that's the only question so far.
Okay, thank you, Joe. All right, so if you're paying attention, remember that step number two on how to ask for major gifts is schedule your meetings. Now, I've been training people on how to do major gift works for a lot of years. And when I started, the thought of having a meeting that was not face-to-face to ask for a lot of money, I couldn't even think about that. I would always advise our clients not to do it. The world has changed. And there's many people, many organizations that are raising 6- and 7-figure gifts without meeting face-to-face with people. You know, I like to call it Zoom to Zoom. You know, could be on the phone, could be WebEx or whatever other, you know, thing you're using. So I just want to encourage people to think creatively, but remember that a meeting is a chance to build a relationship. So you want to find a way for human contact of some sort. This is kind of obvious, but the only way to get a meeting is to schedule it first. That's why this is an actual step. We're not just saying, hey, get organized and go on some meetings. You have to think carefully about how you're going to schedule your meetings. And in fact, as much as I hate to say it, scheduling the meetings is the hardest part of the fundraising process for everybody. You want to use phone or email? I'm going to go through both. These days, email is much more common than picking up the phone to call somebody, but I'm going to go over both just because I think they're important. Yes, to answer a question that may come up, you can use text. I would kind of only use that if it was somebody you already knew. I'm not going over text today, but it's another possibility. Don't write a letter. Nobody's going to wait for a letter to ask for a meeting. I mean, even 20 years ago, that didn't work. To get through this process, this is really like the part of the, if you've ever been in sales, it's kind of the sales part of the process. You want to use that top prospect report I showed you from the getting organized section to keep focused and to keep, you know, working through your list. You want to write yourself actually a phone script and or an email script. I'm going to show you a couple in a few minutes. And even if you're going to do emails, it's not a bad idea to practice some phone calls. Get you comfortable with the whole concept of talking about your organization. And again, if it's a phone call, don't call when you're not in the mood. There's always, you know, later in the day or tomorrow. Don't force yourself. And finally, always follow our rules for phone calls and emails. You're going to see them in just a moment and you'll get them in the slides. They're called rules because, you know, they form a good basis of things, but I'm sure you can also come up with some of your own concepts for how to do this well. So here are our rules for phone calls. I'm going to run through this quickly because, as I said, you know, emails are often what people are using today. You want to state who you are. You want to ask how they are. This is pretty basic sales stuff. Not everybody in sales asks how they are. I think it's important as a fundraiser. Is this a good time? Well, if not, when can I call you back? You want to state the purpose of your call, and you would do the same thing in an email. Sometimes if you say, hi, I'm calling from XYZ nonprofit, they're going to be like, oh no, another telemarketing call. Be clear you're not a telemarketer. The entire purpose of this call is to ask for a meeting. Don't get distracted. And do not have the meeting on the phone. You need to have good boundaries. You want to confirm a time that's going to work. You know, you said Tuesday at 2 o'clock for our Zoom meeting. Fabulous. And sometimes you have to handle objections. Again, if you email me, I'll send you this handout with hints for meetings. And it has a whole bunch of objections and things you might say. So let's focus on the rules for emails for just a few minutes. Again, it's not out of the question that you might call somebody, either on their cell phone, their office phone. Some of us still have home phones. I have one. Only send an email if you're sure it's the right thing to do. Sometimes, particularly before emails were so common, people would send an email because they were scared of making a phone call. And would always think, well, look, eventually you're going to be sitting down face to face with this person. You better get comfortable with the idea. Making a phone call is a great way to start. You want to pick a clear and short personal subject line so the person reads the email. That's in most email communication, that's the most important thing. You want to keep the email short. And I do this all the time. My first draft is never short enough. I want to say enough, but you want to be to the point. The whole point of the email is, you guessed it, to get a meeting. Get them to reply so that you can get a meeting. Start with a friendly phrase if you know the person. And if you don't, start with, you know, connect the dot explanations if you don't know the person. And then you just want to jump right into the reason for writing. I'm hoping we can meet to XYZ. You know, you probably want to say a word or two about the organization. You want to make it as easy as possible for the person to say yes. You don't want to say, hey, you know, I'd like to have a Zoom chat with you next Tuesday at 12 o'clock, or I'm never going to even email you again. You want to be as broad and as might you be able to meet sometime over the next 2 weeks? I'd really appreciate that. And you want to conclude with next steps. I think if there's one constant with everything I ever advise in fundraising is you always need a next step. So here's a sample phone or email script. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this because you can get it in the slides. You want to adjust it for your organization. It's a little different if you're calling than if you're emailing. Obviously, some of this stuff you would not say in an email. But I just want to give you something to start with and then to make it your own. So you can see this is the entire script. It's not very long at all. And then this is really fun. I wanted everybody to see an example of an email that was bad. So please take a minute and read the top and then read the bottom. And I would love it if somebody would put in the chat why they think this is bad. And to be fair, I did not go over a lot of nuances of how to queue up an email, but we can use this as to talk for just a couple minutes about what I think works well and what doesn't. So Natalie, if anybody has a comment in the next minute or so, I'd love to hear it.
Yep, Heather said that the second has too much information and details. Tony said, it is not easy to say yes to, very broad. And Nicolette said, there is no room to discuss.
Yeah, those are all great observations. Thank you. So one of the nuances that to me is really important, in addition to those comments, and let's just look at the email that was sent to Gail and Matt, the top one, from Rhonda. And this is an actual thing that happened in 2020 with one of our clients. So when you're sending this email to ask for a meeting, and this is, she was emailing Gail and Matt, who she actually knows, right? So when you're sending this email, you have to find the right place between, on one end, hi, can I have some money? And the other end, gee, I'd like to talk to you to find out how your summer was. There's something in between there that says enough about your organization and is enough of a carrot to get them to say, yes, I'm willing to meet, but doesn't directly hit them over the head by what she did here. I'd like to meet to discuss the capital campaign. So I would have preferred, and the funny thing is, like, Rhonda unfortunately went through our training and just didn't heed our advice, but I would have liked to hear her say something like, hi, Gail and Matt. The future of our organization is so important to me, and this is a really critical time. Our capital campaign is up and running. While we would love for you to make a gift, what's most important to me is that I connect with you to hear about what you think is important for our future. So, and I just made that up off the top of my head, but that's basically what we generally train people to do. So it's like, you can support the campaign. I'm not pretending the campaign isn't happening. I'm not pretending we don't care about fundraising, but I'm letting you know that while I would love to discuss that, our collective future is really important, and I'm hoping we could spend a little bit of time discussing that. So it's subtle, but it in fact is quite different, and we find it's much easier for people to say yes to that. Because what happened here, and you all would have no way of knowing this, but you know, they offered $1,000, which is a very nice gift, but this is a family that has the capacity to make many times that. They were hoping for $100,000 or $250,000. So it really short-circuited the process. So I'm not gonna belabor it any more than that. I wanna get through our the rest of our steps. So any questions on schedule meetings before we go on to the last step, step three?
There's no questions so far.
Okay, thank you everybody. So step three. So when I do these trainings in person, which as we all know hasn't happened for a while, we spent some time actually doing role play on both those, making a phone call or sending an email, and then actually sitting down in a meeting and asking for a gift. So I'm gonna suggest that you kind of do that on your own, or you pick a friend or colleague to do some meeting role play with. Here are the things that are needed for the third step, which is meeting with the donor and asking for the gift. You want to write a strategic briefing, even if it's just you and the donor. Get your thoughts down on paper or into your computer on a Word doc or Google doc. Be clear on what you're going to say and when you're going to say it. Even more important if it's two people from the nonprofit. We spend a lot of time helping our clients with their strategic briefings and the thought process for what's going to happen in the meeting. This is also really important. Not every meeting will be to ask for a gift. It depends on the stages of engagement. I want to show those to you for just a moment. Some of you will be very familiar with this, but just like in all kinds of other relationships, donor relationships go through stages. Early on, you might not even be sure somebody's capable of a major gift. You have to qualify them, and you're going to cultivate them through conversation. And eventually, often we advise people not to ask on the first meeting. So you're going to cultivate and then at the right point solicit. Once you solicit, that doesn't mean you have the money in your bank account. You have to still close that gift. And if you're so lucky as to get it, you then have to steward, thank people, make sure that they stay connected to your organization. And then ideally you want to resolicit them, but sometimes you kind of get through the cultivate stage and you find that, no, this person's not right. We're going to drop them, or we're going to defer for a year for whatever reason. So we advise that you don't ask for a gift often right in your very first conversation, especially if you're still just cultivating something. So, however, I want you to ask for something every time you meet with somebody, even if that's just to keep the door open to have another meeting. You know, this conversation was really great. I really enjoyed it. It really inspired me. I'm hoping we could have a chat again in a couple months. You want to maintain the focus in that meeting using a gift table like I showed you before, and either handing them a case document that outlines the importance of your organization and your goals, or just verbally telling them that information. You like to have people use these with donors directly. And as I said, you want to practice mock meetings with somebody just to get comfortable. And just like we had rules for emails and phone calls, we've got some rules for meetings. So here they are. I don't know about you, but when I look around at most of us here in the world, most of us have a deficit for being listened to. You're all very kind for this hour to be listening to me talking about this subject. When I was a frontline fundraiser, I would go into people's offices and I would just ask them things about them. And I realized most of the time, These were, you know, executives at all kinds of organizations. Most of the time, people are just walking in their office saying, I need this, I need that. Somebody who comes in and just asks them what they think about a nonprofit that's making the world a better place in such and such a way, that's a novel, interesting thing. Trust me, people are actually going to be interested in talking with you if you can figure out how to listen to them. I want you to always be honest. If you're new at this, like most of the people who weighed in the poll, you don't have to pretend you've been asking people for money for your whole life. You know, hey, I'm just getting started on this process. I'm a little nervous today, and I'm really glad you're one of the first people I'm talking to, because I kind of need some practice. You know, figure out something to say that's honest. Be yourself. I like to suggest that everybody starts their meeting with some casual chit chat to connect, and then it's your job to figure out, okay, we've been talking about the weather and sports, or I don't know, like, you know, clothing or what, I don't know, whatever, or the mall or whatever for 5 minutes. It's time for me to get this meeting going. And when you get the meeting going, you want to use what we call intelligent questions to learn about them. You know, what I know that you've been very generous to a number of organizations in our community. What inspires your philanthropy? A ton of intelligent questions you can ask. And as I said before, in terms of asking, no matter what, make some sort of ask, whether it's for money, for another meeting, or some sort of future continued dialogue. When you're asking for money, it's really important, in my view, that it's not like, hey, you know, could you support us? It's, would you consider a gift of $10,000 before June 30th of this year for our annual fund or for our program to help children in this neighborhood? And then always, just like any negotiation, you want to stop talking after you've made that ask and let the potential donor be the next one to talk. And after you've finished the conversation, you want to state what you've agreed. And as I said before, next steps are really important to me. So you want to state your next steps out loud. I will get back to you in 2 weeks to see what you think about the considering a gift of $10,000, since I know that's a lot of money. And Natalie, that's it for the donor meetings as well. And I'm happy to entertain any questions there.
Yeah, Chantel said it sounded a little bit like an informational interview. Would you say that's correct?
First of all, hello, Chantel. Thank you for joining us. Chantel was at my last webinar. The answer to that, Chantel, is yes, where you're the person doing the interviewing and you have to have your goals in mind. And I'll just say, when I started doing this myself as a fundraiser many years ago, I, like in my first meetings, I was really nervous and I had literally like a whole page of notes for what I wanted to say. And I kept that up probably for a few months, and the notes got smaller and smaller. And at the end of over 10 years of going out and meeting with potential donors, and at this time it was really like going out and meeting, sitting down in offices, homes, restaurants, whatever, I could pretty much do it without, I don't want to say without planning, because it's always important to think about what you're going to do, but I didn't need to do a lot of strategizing, because it kind of gotten into my nervous system on how to do it.
And Brooks is asking, should potential donors be the one to suggest a donation amount?
That is always a terrible idea. So, and I'll tell you what I mean. Most of us are not going to stretch past our comfort level without some sort of external pressure, whether it's for money or you're training for some physical endurance or activity or sport. There's a reason in workouts you do a certain number of reps and all that sort of stuff. Most donors are not going to give their highest gift without that kind of pressure. So is it the end of the world if the donor sets the dollar amount? No, but you generally want to suggest something that is going to, I think it was Joe who asked at the beginning, it's not going to be so outlandish that it's rude, but it's high enough that they can't give you an answer right away, in fact. So just as a quick, for instance, if you're meeting with somebody who you, them, and everybody in the world knows is quite a wealthy person, and they offer you $100,000 the very first time you met them, which is an amazing gift. I don't care what kind of organization you are or how rich anybody is, that's an amazing gift. If they offer you $100,000, you either haven't asked for enough or you haven't waited long enough to ask. Because once you get to know each other and you put a higher figure out, you're going to get more money.
Samaya, and forgive me if I mispronounced your name, is asking, what if a donor doesn't respond back based on the time that's mentioned?
Hi, Samaya. Samaya is actually a member of our team. So thank you for joining us. And what if the donor doesn't answer back in the time mentioned? That's a good question. So there's this word that somehow entered all of our vocabulary. Like before 2 years ago, I'd never heard of it. You know, the term ghosting. Hey, this person ghosted me. This person ghosted me. If there's a few things. One is if you've built the relationship strongly enough before you ask for the money, that shouldn't be a problem. It's another reason you don't want to hurry up the ask, because sometimes hurrying up the ask is just like, okay, I think it's right to ask, but I'm not really sure. And then you haven't really built that dialogue well enough for them to genuinely feel comfortable with your ask. So sometimes you have to sort of chase people a bit. And if you have to chase them too much, it usually means that they're not gonna make the gift. And happy to hear if other people have an opinion on that.
Joe is asking, have you ever asked for a donation of stock or public companies, or of public companies, excuse me? Here in Canada, the donor saves income taxes on the appreciation of their stock.
Yeah, Joe, it's the same thing in the United States. And we've asked for that many times. So I wanna take a step back just for a minute on that question, because really, that's kind of a detail where, just like I generally don't ask, can you meet Tuesday at 12 noon next week to discuss this? I make it more broad. Can you meet sometime over the next couple of weeks at a time that works for you? I would rather that your ask was for a significant gift of whatever amount you've decided to ask for. And I like to front load any details like that before you ask for the amount. So you can say something like, our donors have been making gifts of cash and appreciated securities. And, sometimes I'm really, don't ask me about cryptocurrency, because I know it's happening. People are beginning to make gifts of that. But, our donors are making these kind of gifts. So that already in their mind, they're thinking, oh, okay, I've got these different kinds of assets. I might be able to make a gift of one of those. And then you say, we'd love for you to consider a gift of $10,000 fulfilled however would work for you. I hope that helps, Joe.
That is all the questions we have for right now. Peter, let's hang out for another minute or two just to see if anybody else has some more questions. But if not, I hope everyone enjoyed the presentation. And if you're hopping to another call, I hope you have a great rest of your day.
Yeah, and I'm just gonna pull up a few final slides. I'd encourage everybody to write down three steps they're gonna take right now as a result of this so that you have some action. Again, this is our team. We're happy to help you raise more money than ever before. Feel free to reach out to me. And if you scan this, you can leave us a review. Scan it with your phone, goes to Google, and you'll be able to leave a review. We'd love that. And thank you everybody for sticking with us and spending your hour with us. And yes, Natalie, I'm happy to hang out for a little bit longer.
Lots of thank yous coming in.
Super. And by the way, these are some of the ways you can get in touch with us.
All right. It looks like that's all the questions we have. Thanks, Peter. Right. That was fantastic.
Yeah. Thank you, Natalie. Thank you, everybody. And we'll see you next time.
Bye.